Well, thank you for coming to my trailer for this meeting.
Hi there. It is kind of like a meeting.
It is, yeah.
We are, I guess I'll do an introduction. Should we do an introduction?
Sure.
My name is Teresa Thome. And do I just look at you, right?
There's I guess so, yeah.
The acoustics in here are amazing. I feel like I need to sing.
No.
No.
I am Teresa.
We want people to tune in.
I am Teresa Thome. I am with Fubble Entertainment and one of the producers for the Grand Rapids Community Theater documentary project.
And you like long walks on the beach
and
dinners for two.
I do.
Dinners for three. Why not?
Dinners for three. Ooh, uh-oh.
Who are you?
I'm the other half of Fubble Entertainment. I'm Patrick Ziegler, and I'm one of the producers on the project, the Grand Rapids Theater documentary as well.
So you're the other half of Fubble. So she's the Fub, you're the Bull.
Yes, that is
no,
true.
No, the other way around.
And you, my sir.
Well,
friend.
I am Todd Lewis. I'm helping with this whole project. Hello there, little guy.
That's a stink bug.
Helping everybody. With this project and as kind of director, editor, and just really excited about what we're doing.
Yeah.
What are we doing?
We're doing a documentary on the local theater community here in Grand Rapids, why they do theater, why it's such an important part of their lives, and what sets this community apart from the other theater communities out there. And the more, we've already done some filming, and what I've found is that everyone we talk to, we just really are realizing what we already suspected, which is how unique this community truly is in the country and probably within the world.
Yeah.
We're very lucky to have so many people that for them theater is a passion, not just a career, and for some of them it's a career, for others they're doing it for the love, but the one common thread is everyone takes it as seriously as if we were in New York doing something on Broadway, off Broadway. We're off Broadway here. But the passion and the sense of seriousness is unparalleled. And we hear that a lot from people who have gone other places and done theater and have come back here. And just that's the common thread that I'm hearing. What about you guys?
One of the things that's coming out the most for me is just the universal theme of community and community theater, that it started out as a story about Grand Rapids Community Theater, but it's really becoming more about community theater at large. Mm-hmm. And I really like that because there's two components to it. There is the documentary itself, but there is the supporting website that will have more interviews, more about Grand Rapids, and more about the history of Grand Rapids there, and people talking about their experiences in Grand Rapids. But for me, I love to hear about why people are doing this, why people do community theater, and what a supportive family it becomes. So that's become a really interesting story, and also what we're finding also is just the different stages of life within community theater. So it was fun in the webathon talking to the seasoned people, you know, and then talking to somebody young, like even Michael Stewart, who's starting here, but also Jake Mate, and, you know, their path into it. So I love all of all those aspects coming out in it.
How about you?
I just wanted to be on camera again. And I'm not, so I'm disappointed in the whole project.
Your voice is here and there.
My voice is here and there. I think that I love how, because I'm such a type A personality, and so I can't be that for this project because it is shifting and reshaping itself as we kind of go through the project. So it's really challenging me as a storyteller to try to figure out how to tell the story that we want to tell. I look at, we just spent 3 hours today doing a telethon or a webathon, and we didn't scratch the surface of the stories. And that scares the heck out of me because there's so much story to be told.
Really, this could be a this could be a series.
You want to know, I actually thought about that. I was like, is this a Ken Burns 8-part documentary for Grand Rapids?
Yeah, the Grand Rapids component, possibly. But the documentary itself, the story itself, I think is can be contained.
Right. But I think that's been very exciting for me, and I think what Patrick talked about, you know, it's like listening to Jake Mate today and some of the people that we've interviewed, trying to get them to define what is the theater bug, that you've been bitten by the theater bug, you've been bitten by the stink bug, but what is that, you know? Jake was like, it's, you know, and then to me, that's, It's like Fred Cebulski saying, you know, I realized I could direct. You know, I just, we want, for us, we want a Hamilton reference. We want to be in the room where it happens. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't matter in many ways what part we are playing when we're in the room where it happens. It's just so
being in the room.
Soulful and soul-enriching and life-enriching to be in the room.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting what you're saying because the documentary is kind of becoming what theater is, because what you're saying is you're a type A person, but you don't always know where your path is going to go. Like Fred said, you know, he got into acting, all of a sudden he directed, first time directed, mm-hmm. you know, and didn't know, had never done it before. And it's like, you know, first time I wrote something, Teresa mocked the heck out of me. You know? So it's like, who?
Because I should
that's
have.
What you do. So.
But who knew, you know, that I would be working as a writer and a producer and all of that? I always loved those components of it, but it's more about, oh, now my path is going to go this way because that's how your life happens, mm-hmm. the story of your life, if you will. So we're kind of doing that same thing with the documentary. All of a sudden it's like, well, we think it's going to be this, this, and this.
Yeah.
And then somebody brings something up and it goes, oh, wait a minute. That's an interesting aspect. I think we're definitely landing on the
through line, if you will, of it, or the,
but
the heart
it's still,
of it.
Yeah. It's still molding.
Well, that's what I found really fascinating, too. And you know, for anyone that doesn't know, that one of the major differences between a documentary and a narrative film is a narrative film, you have a script that's been written sometimes for years ahead of time. You've got the story arc, you know, everything. Everyone knows the story they're telling. We know as much as we know about the theater community, we kind of have a feeling of the stories. But then as you start making it, you realize how it can take you in a different direction. So this documentary will be constantly evolving mm-hmm. as it's being created, much like the rehearsal process of a play, as you're finding the characters, even mm-hmm. though you've got a script and you're, well, what if it's this, what if it's that? And and when you have this many creative people involved, I mean, you know, we're just interviewing person after person after person, all of whom are super creative people, who are super passionate people, who are good at what they do, whether they're on stage as an actor or whether they're behind the scenes as a lighting designer or a set designer or a volunteer that's working with the set. I mean, there's all of these people are so passionate about it and so good at what they do. They're all going to, what they talk about is going to make this evolve as well.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's really fascinating. And I'm excited to see when we get all of the stuff that we're compiling and we start putting it together. Mm-hmm. That's where I think the real interesting things are going to start to happen. But the thing that we're hearing a lot in common from people too is the sense of theater being a family.
Right.
And that's something I think it's easy to take for granted.
Yeah.
Especially for people who don't do it as a living. Oh, I guess even for people who do it as a living, it might even be less common because mm-hmm. now it's a job. Here, everyone's doing this for the love of it.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You know, even the people who are being paid something are doing it for the passion of it.
They're not Dr. Lynn.
They're not getting rich. Yeah. Yeah. You know, nobody's getting rich in this town doing this. We're doing it for the passion. So you get this sense of, I think of the movie Fight Club, where Tyler Durden, the character played by Brad Pitt, talks about single-serving friends, you know, mm-hmm. that these are people you meet on an airplane and you have a conversation with them for a couple of hours as you're flying somewhere, and he calls them single-serving friends. I think there's a similar thing to that in theater sometimes, except it's a little bit broader in that you have, you know, single production families mm-hmm. sometimes.
Yeah.
And sometimes those families continue in extended ways. Michael Stewart talked about
that
today when he did
American Idiot.
And then you have others where you feel so close for 2 months, 3 months as you're doing the show, and then you all go your separate ways and you hardly see each other again.
Right.
But you know what? The second you're in that room with that person again, you have this unspoken thing, familial thing.
Yeah, you have a common theme.
Yeah.
I also think it's really important, the reason that we originally kind of started this was because so many of the people that were the original storytellers are no longer with us.
Yeah.
And
so
we wanted to tell their stories, like the Norma Brinks and Marty Childs
and
Cedric.
Paul.
Lowell Seibel.
Yeah. And so Fred Cebulski, you know, mentioned that now, to him, those were always the people that were telling the stories, and now he's finding he's that person. And even as we sit there and I looked at the different people, I'm like, wow, we're kind of that middle.
We're the Fred Sebulski and Gene Reed Baileys. Like not in terms of respect.
Right. Yeah.
But of that age. Yeah. Like when we started doing theater, they were even a little younger than us.
They were younger than us. Mm-hmm.
So it's like, wow, we are.
When we started doing theater, they were younger than
yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, than yeah. what we are right now. Yeah.
Right.
Which is crazy.
Yeah.
And amazing.
But that was one of the very first reasons we started when we came up with the idea, was just kind of like, but also just about how unique it is, because it also being, Grand Rapids is not a big town, it's not a tiny town by any means, but how many theaters are in this community?
Yeah, it's crazy.
And just the opportunity and the quality, you know, so we wanted to continue to talk about that.
Oh, yeah, we didn't think Don and Bluma.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah. Oh, did you say Don and Bluma?
Oh, you mean as far as donation?
Yeah.
I don't remember. But what we said we were going to put it on the list.
Yeah. Well, and that is wonderful. I mean, it's something, again, unique to this community. If you want to do the blockbuster, the Annies, Christmas Carols, the Peter Pans, things like that, you've got Civic Theater that really excels at those.
Yeah.
But if you want to do something that's, kind of cutting edge, a little less known, a little smaller, something, you've got Actors Theater that's always pushing the boundaries of theater.
Or
and
Ebony
then you've got
Circle,
and then you've got this wonderful diversity that's happening in this community with Jewish Theater, with Ebony Road Players, and Master
and
Arts.
Circle and plays that a little bit.
Circle's kind of in that wonderful, which is why I was thinking the other day, the last 10 years, I've done almost solely shows at Circle, and I was wondering why that was, and I think it's...
Because nobody else will cast.
Nobody else will cast? Darn it, Teresa, now it's everyone knows.
Nice.
So, cast me, please. is that I think they're doing... their shows, they do a variety of types of shows, so they're a harder theater, I think, to categorize. Like this season alone, they did Brighton Beach Memoirs.
Right.
They did Chorus Line, which is known by so many people. And they did To Kill a Mockingbird, which is a show I would not have thought Circle Theater would have tackled. And it ended up being, I believe, their most attended play.
That's great.
And Chorus Line ended up being their most attended
more than Brighton Beach
of all time.
Wow.
So they're finding a way of getting to everyone and having something for everyone, which is great.
Well, and I think that's part of the other piece of us doing this that Patrick was starting to articulate why we went down this path to begin with. We want people to come and enjoy the theater.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think I asked Tommy about it, Tommy Allen, who we've talked to in the making of this, about the importance of it. And that's something I always thought about when I was at the Children's Museum, is in the technological age that we have, it's getting harder and harder. I mean, even for myself, our brains are so programmed to move through information so quickly.
Mm-hmm.
We have to find ways to give people an opportunity to slow down, to breathe and to connect with something that takes 2 hours to communicate.
Mm-hmm.
And even
have a collective experience.
Have a collective experience. Everybody sitting in the room. I mean, these are some of the realizations that are coming through that I think are so important as we're going through this process, is we need to let people know this is what theater is doing for a community. And you talk about shows like Carolina Change and The Nether at Actors Theater, and just over the course of time, and Torchlight Trilly and Corpus Christi and all these shows that have, I mean, there's two things happening here. People are going to escape just because I want to be entertained.
Right.
You know, I want It's a Hard Knock Life. I'm going to sing any chance I can. But they also want to be challenged.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the great things about being involved in community theater. I think I talked all over the place on that sentiment, but I'm glad we're doing it, the documentary, because I want us to be able to expand our audiences. If I can have done anything for my theater community to help build awareness, I mean, I will feel like,
and what a wonderful thing
something.
For the audiences of the future. I mean, I'm so worried about children never getting to experience I think about it. What if I had never gone to a theater show? What if my parents had never taken me to a movie? Would I be doing any of the things that I'm doing now? Probably not.
Right.
What if my sister never took me to Bumbershoot at Circle
Theater? Yeah, it changed your life.
Yeah. And I don't think it was called Bumbershoot. I think it was called like Bumber Sniggles or something like that.
I like Bumbershoot. Let's call it that. Whatever it was called.
I have something.
Circle. I just want to say Circle and Civic Theater, in terms of how many children they are serving, is phenomenal, yeah. The kind of work. And one of the other things, too, is the amount of education that happens in this community through Aquinas, mm-hmm. And Grand Valley and JC, CC. Mm-hmm. We are, and actor, you know, Civics School of Education, we are so lucky to have this much education in our community that values, places so much value on the process for both in front of the footlights and behind the footlights.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I think, you know, one of the interesting, most challenging things is the financial piece for us. And so we just did this webathon, and which was so much fun. And so, like, I don't know who's done this before, and, you know, and this form. And
I know, 19.
I'm hoping that maybe this might open up a door for community theaters to go,
I know,
that was a unique way of raising some money and, you know, whatever they can do. But, you know, it's interesting. We decided to do a documentary on community theater. That community theater already is challenged by getting money, raising money. So it's like, well, let's do a,
documentary. Let's raise some more money.
Yeah. So it's interesting that, you know, that's kind of coming to me and about why we're doing this. And once again, we had to say to the community, hey, step up. You've stepped up in other ways. Step up again. And they did today, and I think they will continue.
Yeah.
I think this really kind of put a bigger face on the why, even though our video at the beginning really showed, oh, this is needed, this is why it's really needed.
Yeah.
You know, and so that just came to me. And, you know, obviously, people can continue to donate at grtheaterdocumentary.com.
I don't know if we can say that. They can edit it out if they're not on WKTV.
Oh, oopie.
We're not raising any
I'll always
any
throw
money.
That out there.
That's right.
I
that's
know.
Right.
My God.
So,
we'll just wear it. You just need to have a general Chiron. Like, just carrying a holographic Chiron. Yeah.
I feel like I want to go roast hot dogs now.
I think, that's our time.
Yeah.
So,
it was great. I mean,
been a great journey with you gents, and we've got
a lot more to go.
We've only just begun. We
have
only
driving
just
down
begun.
The road. Yeah, but it's exciting so far, and I can't wait to see how it comes out.
I know.
That's great.
Yay. Well, thanks WKTV for asking.
Yes.
Yeah, thanks WKTV. We love you.
Yay.